Let's talk about the digital cockpit. At the end of 2024, we froze the design of the production PFD and got that implemented on flying target hardware. As we entered 2025, we've concentrated solely on implementing the production version of the MFD and then the IPI and freezing those two for implementation on target hardware. Tonight, I'm going to run through some of the last few features to be implemented on the PFD before taking you through some of the newer features of both the MFD and the IPI. Since the last AMA, we've implemented autopilot bugs for altitude, speed, and heading, which are now shown in cyan on the relevant instruments. We've bounded the touch zones for all of the key buttons using highlighted bands for ease of reference. We've reordered the radio bar to make the single comm configuration and the frequency listing much more consistent. We've tweaked the position of some of the text fields on the upper data bar to suit the new IPI and the warning displays, all with the same refined, crisp final design of the user interface. In the unlikely event that a caution or warning is triggered in the digital cockpit, the user interface has been designed to provide the pilot with emotionally sensitive enunciations. What this means that in addition to the standard warning light, you'll also get the key information from the POH paraphrased, telling the pilot what's wrong and what to do in simple language. The system still needs to be able to cope with multiple warnings triggered simultaneously without obscuring critical flight information. Therefore, we've implemented a caution advisory system panel below the main alert banner. A pilot can clear the large warning banner, but the CAS messages and annunciator panel lights will remain on until the condition is resolved. A simple, clean, and intuitive system providing the best information to inexperienced owner-operators. When the aircraft is being operated with a non-flying passenger in the front left seat, generally the second screen on the left-hand side is used as either infotainment or as a video feed. For a number of months now, we've been investigating the viability of using that real estate on the screen to display a large traffic scope, giving the pilot the best situational awareness. However, after careful consideration, we've come to the conclusion that you are still better off seeing traffic information overlaid on your mapping information to give it better context and to relay the immediate threats through the HSI in the center of the PFD display. The benefit of doing it this way is it means we've now got completely free rein to develop a completely optimized user interface for non-flying passengers where they can safely control the climate control functions, Bluetooth phone connectivity, Bluetooth streamed music, and all of the camera feeds from the aircraft. The new MFD display features a crisp, clean design, completely synchronized with the primary flight display. A large camera feed window is positioned on the right-hand side of the screen, featuring forward, tail view, rear view, and downward-facing cameras. Expandable menus are available on the right-hand side for phone connectivity and Bluetooth streamed music. At the bottom of the screen, we have a clean menu bar providing fast access to each of the functions controllable by the non-flying passenger, including climate control, music, phone, camera views, and user preferences. The large video feed window allows you to select the front, tail, rear, and downward cameras and maximize any of these camera views to a full screen view. The MFD can be reverted back to a duplicate set of flight instruments. HX50 has been designed from the ground up to be a digitally enabled aircraft, a machine fit for 2025 and beyond. As far as legally practicable, we've designed the whole operating system to be paperless, using cloud-based secure digital record keeping for the aircraft technical and operational logs and the pilot logs. To do this, the digital handshake between the pilot and the aircraft and support crew and the aircraft needs to be seamless and extremely secure. This will be delivered through the HIL app. On power-up, the PFD and the MFD will display a brief splash screen before immediately reverting to their flight-ready modes to avoid unnecessary animation or delay. The IPI, on the other hand, will boot up to a login page requesting the pilot's credentials to ensure that they have permission granted to fly the aircraft and then logging all of those flight operations to his account. By default, the login welcome screen remembers the last login and prompts for a PIN number. By entering your PIN, the system activates your saved preferences and logs the flight time to your account. If a different pilot's flying, then the pilot can select Change Pilot. When the Change Pilot page is active, the system will list all recent pilots or give the user an option to add a profile. Adding a profile is done via a connection to the HIL app over the aircraft network that validates the user's credentials on the HIL app against the aircraft. In this way, owners can control who flies their aircraft and ensure that each pilot is qualified, current, medically fit, and insured, and that the aircraft and pilot records are completed automatically and accurately. Once logged in, the homepage provides fast access to all key functions. COM1, COM2 radios, the audio panel settings, your barometric settings, and the transponder. We can also provide fast access to other system pages such as the autopilot, Bluetooth phone, Bluetooth music, climate controls, screen and camera settings, and broader system settings. When the autopilot is active, the autopilot menu extends and provides fast access to the modes and bug settings. By swiping across either COM1 or COM2, left or right, a pop-up volume slider will appear that allows the COM volume to be quickly adjusted without needing to delve deep into menus. The volume icon brings up the audio panel volume settings. Similarly, if you swipe left or right along the COM1 or COM2 radio bar areas on the PFD, then this too will pop up a volume slider bar that allows you to rapidly and directly control the volume of both COM1 and COM2 radios without delving into any menu structures. We've added a list button to the cyclic stick head, which gives you fast access to listed and stored frequencies in the radio's memory, whether that be nearest, recents, or your synchronized list from the HIL app. Once logged into their unique profile, each user can store their operating preferences for the displays, what's displayed on their screen, the brightness, their default units, their Bluetooth connections, their network connections for people that want to sync more than one iPad at a time, and then the pilot station settings for audio, PFD options, and synchronized lists with the HIL app. They can also configure their electronic flight book settings, including which third-party navigation app connection they want to use and what the preferences for that application are. In parallel with the user interface application development, the team have been extensively testing the display processor hardware. The display processor must seamlessly combine the user interface application, the background layers, the touch functionality, and all of the video feeds, as well as the communication between devices. It must do so while delivering a smooth user experience at about 60 frames per second and a seamless touch experience. Generally, so far in the testing, we've found that the user experience is great and the hardware keeps up just fine, but there is some scope for improved memory management and improved performance. So the guys are currently optimizing this right now to get the best out of the hardware and give us the largest margin for future capability growth. Once this testing is complete, then the testing can be extended to the integration of the peripheral devices.